Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Servo Battalion by Andrei Livadny. Translated by Sophia Gutkin. Narrated by Aaron Shedlock. Prologue. August 22nd, 2627, Earth Years. Hammer's Line. The sultry, overcast midday on Vesuvius was lit up by a multitude of eruptions. The air was unbreathable, poisoned by the volcanic emissions, and the sky, like a gray sheet, hung low and reflected the crimson of the fiery chaos below. The world laid out below the oppressive sky appeared unfit for human life, but the war had changed many of the suitability criteria. Vesuvius was not just colonized, but densely populated with the industrial bases of the Terran Alliance located here, which repaired the technology damaged in the fighting. Through an anomaly in space, damaged spaceships were towed from sites of battle into orbit around the planet, and were then brought down to the surface using special technical carriers. There were also plenty of transports carrying broken servo machines, with some to be repaired and some intended for disassembly into spare parts. Vesuvius hosted not only repair docks for large ships, but also factories for restoring planetary technology. The harsh conditions of the hot young planet, whose volcanic activity meant that additional camouflage was unnecessary, and where natural resources lay practically on the surface, had another advantage. Its training grounds for testing repaired servo machines ideally met the criteria for close-to-combat conditions. Donald Crowe had an easy attitude to life. Serving on the testing grounds of Vesuvius would not seem like a cushy job at other times, but with a war raging across the entirety of colonized space and claiming huge numbers of victims, life under a low, leaden sky seemed like paradise, if the alternative was almost certain death. So he didn't complain about his fate. Today did not promise any trouble, and hardly differed from Donald's hundreds of other days, bland and boring, filled with difficult but not dangerous work. Today he had to run through tests for 3 hoplites repaired after fierce fighting. It was nothing complicated or unusual. A walk through the broken and treacherous terrain with poor visibility due to the volcanic ash constantly falling from the sky. A couple of jumps using the jet accelerators over the narrow rivers of lava crossing the plain, and some target shooting. Apart from having to spend several hours in an old combat suit with a faulty thermoregulation system, Donald did not anticipate any issues. Leaving the hangar, Crowe strode confidently over to the last mechanism in the line. Hoplite 2M was a new model that promised to become the real paratrooper workhorse in the near future. Approaching the 45-ton giant, Donald couldn't help but note the mechanism's appearance. Both guns had been replaced. The weapon pylons on the right had newly assembled missile tubes, and the anti-aircraft turret was completely absent, with 2 medium-powered lasers installed instead. Interesting configuration, Crowe thought as he circled around the servo machine. Beneath a coat of fresh chameleon coating, currently deactivated, some of the armor plates showed numerous pitting. It really got hit hard, Donald thought with surprise, noting that all the armored covers protecting the servo motor nodes looked factory fresh and glossy. They had been replaced, like most of the Saram Light segments. It appeared that the servo mechanism hadn't just sustained critical damage, but had been literally riddled with bullets. It was difficult to imagine the slaughter that the hoplite had been in to sustain such damage. Fine, my job is to test the machine. Donald, in an excellent mood, opened the protective screen and touched the technical access sensor into the cabin. The hatch opened obediently, and the lift segment slid down from above. Whistling a cheerful tune, Donald ascended to the cabin, crossed the airlock, and found himself inside the servo machine. The overview screen switched on when he appeared, and the mobile control panel surrounding the pilot cradle moved aside, providing access to the chair. He switched on telecommunication through the implant. This didn't initiate the full-scale neurosensory contact of a person with the Maverick system, but rather enabled third-level mental commands, which were quite sufficient for technical testing, especially since the machine would perform most of the operations itself. Donald's role was to throw it sudden curveballs, which the cyber system had to respond to quickly and appropriately. Well, baby, shall we begin? The communication channel responded with a ringing silence. The control panels automatically returned to their places. The autopilot lights switched on. The machine indicated its full readiness to undergo testing, but the Maverick module was refusing to talk to the human. Donald got angry. He was normally quite easygoing, even a bit cowardly, and it was only when dealing with the soulless and obedient machines that he behaved arrogantly. After all, no matter what they said about the new generation AI and the Mavericks, according to the specifications, Beatrice 4 was installed aboard this hoplite. Crow always regarded machine intelligence as a cheap fake. So what if it's an AI? What's he supposed to do? Talk to every infantry android like they're his equal now? Now, baby, stop acting up. You've probably got a cute voice. Come on, say good morning, pilot. The silence in the communicator was now deafening. It seemed thick as syrup, hostile and unpleasant. Fine, I'll deal with you. Donald thought with a touch of irritation as he buckled on his harness. The cushioning arcs of the pilot cradle, which would be ejected if the machine sustained critical damage, automatically closed around him. The control panels moved even closer, and all the indicator lights signaled readiness to commence testing. Forward, straight ahead for 500 meters, then turn 90 degrees to the right. Go. The hoplite didn't move. Piece of shit. Who do you think you are, you metal lump? I clearly said go. Something unbelievable happened in the next instant. Instead of obeying the order, the machine suddenly lit up an angry warning signal on the control panel. And then came the characteristic sound of the cabin's armor plates opening like a metal bud, and the pilot cradle, together with a stunned Donald, was flung into the gloomy skies of Vesuvius by the emergency catapult. The hoplite catapulted the pilot, switched on the telemetry channel, reporting about the functioning systems to the testing ground central control room, and then started moving. 500 meters straight ahead, and then to the right, and kept moving on its own initiative, overcoming various obstacles in its way and shooting at any suddenly appearing targets. By the time Donald Crow freed himself from the safety harness and hobbled over to the command post, the hoplite had already completed its test program, independently returned to the hangar, and stopped in the center of the marking circle. Entering the control room, Donald let out a loud stream of abuse, his helmet already unclipped. The man in charge of the testing grounds, a major who had lost both his arms in the fighting and now wore cyber prostheses instead, looked at the enraged pilot and said, "Calm down." "Calm down? That blasted machine tossed me out of the cabin."
"I saw it."
"And?"
Crow's face twisted in a mean grimace.
"You clearly weren't to Beatrice's liking," the major replied coolly. "I've looked through the documents, and it appears that she lost her pilot in the last battle. Then she came to us."
"So? What? She's in shock? She can't see other people? She won't listen to other people's orders? She's missing her pilot?"
"Yes," the major replied with cold hostility in his voice.
"Since when are Mavericks allowed to have emotions and, moreover, to throw people out of their cabins?"
"Her pilot was killed,"
the senior officer at the testing ground repeated, as if he hadn't heard Donald's words. Unlike Crow, he knew what it was like to lose friends in battle. And, comparing the boorish behavior of the test pilot with the restrained reaction of the AI after it had experienced the pain of loss, he found the comparison not in Crow's favor.
"Look," the major said tiredly, "the machine has fully passed the test. It's serviceable. Go ahead and sign the test certificate, and we'll forget about what happened."
"What?"
"What nothing. I have made my decision. The test was successful, and the hoplite has been recommended for use in automatic unmanned mode. Sign it, or I swear to God, I'll find a way to send you to the front."
Donald's jaw dropped and he turned pale. It was the first time he had seen the stolid major look absolutely furious, and didn't doubt for a moment that the man would carry out his promise.
"Damn it. Okay, I'll sign it," Crow said aloud.
Bending over the sheet of plast paper containing the test results and adding his signature, Donald glanced at the other papers out of the corner of his eye. For most of the machines in the latest batch, the same sender was listed. 13th Servo Battalion. Chapter 1. June 25th, 2624. Hammer's Line. They arrived on Unona as part of the latest reinforcements. 200 young people, aged 17 to 19. The shuttle that brought them from the General Military Transport landed at sunrise, when Una's flaming disk had barely appeared above the horizon. Their first impression of a planet fully terraformed and covered in greenery was misleading. Beneath the masking plantations of identical coniferous trees, modified at the military laboratories of New Earth, hid a branching network of military bases, spaceports, and testing grounds. The planet was far from the enormous park it looked to be from orbit, but rather a single research and testing facility where new types of weapons were put through their paces. The captain, meeting the new recruits, waited until the disorderly crowd got itself organized and stopped chattering. Heat emanated from the shuttle, and in the gradually setting silence, they could hear the crackling of the armor plates as they cooled down. Shreds of morning mist drifted up from a small valley formed by the network of drainage ditches along the edge of the landing field. Una's orange rays illuminated the treetops with a fiery and poisonous shade of crimson, which seemed unnatural to the inhabitants of Earth, and all of it together created an indelible impression that made the newcomers fall silent. The captain waited patiently, knowing that Unona itself would silence the youth better than any yelling. The inhabitants of Earth's megacities, who had never seen such careless and disorganized open space before, and still did not fully comprehend where and why they had been brought here, eventually fell silent, and their eyes unwittingly turned to the officer standing alone.
"Boys and girls,"
he spoke quietly, even insinuatingly, making the last voices fall silent.
"I know that only a few of you have come here voluntarily by signing up at the mobilization centers. However, it's no longer important what desires, motivations, beliefs, or lack thereof made you avoid mobilization or voluntarily come to the recruitment center. Look around you and understand that you are on a different planet, outside your usual environment. I'm not going to yell at you and call you scum and promise to make a cool soldier out of each one of you. Those of you who have watched too many bad movies can forget about that. You are now servo machine pilots. Your first step off the shuttle has become a step from a carefree civilian life into war. There's no way back. Nobody is going to demean you or try to break you to turn you from rabble into real soldiers. Where you're going, only the strongest and most skilled ones will survive. Forget everything that happened in the past. From now on, each one of you has an identity. The identity of a pilot. Only your personal qualities will determine who will live and who will die in the first battle. Mark my words, and those of you who are lucky will remember them often. A servo machine pilot is an individual, first and foremost. For the technological might capable of destroying any obstacle will be placed in your hands. The concept of friendship often loses its meaning in modern warfare. There will be no living combat companions beside you, only machines. This is why everyone needs to learn how to be a leader. I repeat, it doesn't matter who you were yesterday. And now, he turned, follow me.
He seems kinda nuts, probably totally shell-shocked.
An African-American guy muttered defiantly.
What do you reckon?
He turned to the skinny teenager of European descent next to him.
What's your name?
Anton,
the boy said curtly.
I'm Simon, Simon Green.
He slowed down slightly, matching his stride to Anton's.
Let's stick together.
All right,
Anton replied readily.
Hey, how were you picked up?
Very simply, they brought us all here for one reason.
Vercolan was staring at his feet, as if some unexpected obstacle could appear on the spaceport's smooth plates.
Free account in the lair, and the tournament arena.
The lair? So what?
Simon snorted.
I was hanging out there daily, and?
Use your head. What was the arena simulating?
Simon pursed his full lips.
You reckon?
He asked suspiciously.
Of course, war games are great, especially when there's nothing better to do. But not to this extent.
Exactly to this extent, responded Rakolin.
Simon fell quiet, inadvertently drawing his head into his shoulders. No, he didn't get scared. It was a different sensation. He suddenly understood that what the officer had said weren't empty phrases.
Damn, he talked to us like we were equals, Simon thought suddenly. Could Anton be right, and the reason that I've been brought to this strange and freakish world, like the others, was because of the total number of points that I accumulated playing the virtual servo machine simulator?
Simon could theoretically accept, of course, that if he suddenly landed in the cabin of a hoplite or phalanger, he wouldn't simply hang his mouth open in surprise. But the officer walking nearby seemed convinced that they were capable of much more. He glanced at Anton, but the wish to discuss their sudden prospects with his new friend had disappeared for some reason.
Let's see then. Let's see why they dragged us all here.
Humanity, at least the part that had set the war in motion, twice had a real chance to stop the fighting, but had never used it. Why? Why, despite the massive casualties and current deadlock, did the war not die down, but, on the contrary, flared up with a new, fierce, and uncompromising intensity? It was said that within 5 years after the blockade of Debog was broken, the war was being fought mostly by machines on the side of the Alliance. It was this factor that intensified the conflict and didn't let it stop. A generally accepted lie. War was always begun and ended by humans, while machines remained faithful to non-existent forces for thousands of years, or to put it more simply, they remained hostage to the programs that humans had installed in them. July 18th, 2624. Aboard the cruiser Apostle, flagship of the 7th Strike Fleet of the Terran Alliance. Admiral Kupanov sat comfortably in his chair, his eyes half closed, surrendering to the power of virtual reality. An emergency meeting had just commenced, and communication between the flagships of the 7 strike fleets was carried out using floating hypersphere frequency channels, which made the conversation impossible to intercept. The Galactic War was in its 15th year. The Terran Alliance forces, unable to take over the developed colony planets, had been drawn into a war against an opponent whose financial and technical capabilities were now equal to humanity's ancestral home.
Gentlemen, I must begin our meeting with some unfortunate news. John Winston Hammer died early this morning.
The senior Navy officer stood up in silence. Their faces revealed neither sorrow nor happiness, nor shock. All those invited to the meeting had thousands of reasons to hate and fear the man who had started the war, but each one kept their emotions under tight control.
Please be seated, said Admiral Nagumo after a pause.
He had hardly changed in the 15 years of fighting and still looked the same, a lean old man with a wrinkled face and piercing eyes.
Due to John Hammer's death, I have assumed the duties as head of the world government and supreme commander.
Nagumo's words were met with a heavy and tangible silence, not broken by even a murmur. This was the obvious outcome of the behind-the-scenes struggles occurring in recent years since Alexander Nagumo had commanded the Fleet Joint General Staff for over 10 years, and none of the admirals present wondered about the legality of such a statement. They stood silent, as if in agreement, and waited to see what would happen next. There was a detached and expectant pause with the announcement of John Hammer's death. Everyone knew that it was possible to stop the war right now and enter into negotiations with the Free Colonies, for the man whose personal decision had marked the beginning of armed hostilities was now dead. Everyone knew this, and yet the 7 admirals, commanders of the Alliance Aerospace Forces, stood silent, each one waiting for something, plotting certain plans, like Kupanov, for example, who didn't even think about raising the issue of ceasing hostilities. He looked at Nagumo and thought, noting the smallest details in the man's appearance, whose fame was as great as it was sinister.
He's not going to remain in power for long. He's old. He's past his prime, plus he's got plenty of enemies. What will happen when there's another coup? 7 fleets, 7 admirals. The Alliance is in danger of falling apart. Nagumo's voice interrupted his thoughts. Each one of you will today receive a detailed plan of action for the fleet for the near future. We are radically changing our strategy. We are moving to a large-scale envelopment of the Central Worlds Cluster to blockade strategic hypersphere routes and to capture the remote colonies from the time of the Great Exodus, who have not yet been drawn into the war. The pendulum of war, frozen for a moment of time in the dead center, began moving once again under the icy silence of the powers that be. None of the people present tried to challenge Nagumo's words, to disagree or suggest something. Moreover, it seemed that negotiations with the free colonies promised nothing but a quick dismissal for the admirals commanding the various fleets. Each one thought about himself, and none thought about humanity.
May I ask a question, Admiral?
The oppressive silence of conformism was broken by a young and daring voice.
Yes, I'm listening.
Nagumo didn't even turn his head. He knew without having to look who dared to speak up. A man called Tabanov rose from his seat, the commander of the 5th Fleet and the youngest in the new wave of senior officers. A dark horse, according to the majority.
The presence of a detailed plan implies that it was developed by John Hammer himself?
It's a provocative question, but I will answer it. The idea is mine, Nagumo replied,
nevertheless giving Tabanov a sour look.
It was clear at the beginning of the war that we were making a mistake by letting the colonies explore beyond the known space, that we are losing the strategic initiative, creating a network of military bases and planetary strongholds, which will enclose the central worlds in a kind of sphere, will enable us to form an exclusion zone within the boundaries of known space. This will prevent the resisting colonies from increasing their might by using resources from remote star systems. This is the right strategy for the future, and at the same time, our main tactical goal at the moment. Each fleet will have its own special task in the upcoming large-scale operation.
Kupanov listened to Nagumo without interrupting. Any needless questions asked now would surely backfire later. Nagumo had an excellent memory. Pavel Petrovich was not only an experienced admiral, but also a seasoned politician. He had begun his career commanding the artillery deck on the cruiser Engraus, which took part in the first attack on Debog, was promoted to the rank of fleet commander, and knew very well that beneath Nagumo's generalities lay a new strategy for military action in space. The ability to analyze a situation and to perceive not only the thoughts expressed aloud, but also their subtext often helped him in difficult situations in the constant struggle for power. Like now, when he intuitively understood that Nagumo wasn't just outlining a new strategy, but eliminating a threat by moving the fleets around and deliberately separating them, giving each admiral their own task and a certain sector of space. The old man did not want to lose power nor step away from the decision-making, but what will happen when he's gone?
He's trying to find a leader among us, a person capable of occupying a high position and keeping the Alliance from splintering.
Nagumo's words did sound like the go-ahead for a short but fierce race to the top spot to most of those present, the results of which would be used by Nagumo to announce his successor, while he withdrew into the shadows with a guarantee of personal immunity.
Well, let's see what he's planning for the 7th Fleet, the Admiral thought.
He had no doubt that in addition to the shared goals for this war, each task hit a chance or a pitfall. Nagumo wanted to see which one of his admirals would understand the hint and not only reach the goal, but also gain a distinct advantage for himself. The meeting continued, but Kupanov didn't pay much attention to the reports. He had identified the key idea and now couldn't wait to see the files with the specific tasks set before his fleet. He had accepted the rules of the game proposed by the Supreme Commander and wasn't going to miss the chance to become the first among equals. The cruiser Apostle, 12 hours later. The next day, Admiral Kupanov called a meeting of the senior officers. He was correct in his intuitive prediction of the situation, but he wasn't planning to reveal his thoughts to the officers. The admiral kept his ideas to himself, picturing the possible future scenarios.
Gentlemen, a new strategy has been announced.
He turned to the silent and waiting audience. Kupanov mentally switched on the holographic data output system. A 3D image of space appeared in the middle of the vast room. Many stars were marked with different labels, conventional signs whose presence and position allowed the invited officers to get a clear idea about the current situation on the battlefronts of the Galactic War. The five star systems where the planetary civilizations of the colonists were able, after 400 years of isolation, to re-enter space before the invasion from Earth, were surrounded by dense clusters of different symbols. There were markers of space minefields and outposts floating in space. Closer to a star system, the field of symbols became denser, forming powerful space defenses. However, recent major combat operations were not being fought in the central world systems. Instead, the desperate and bloody battles occurred at a distance of 5 to 7, even 10 light years away from the colonies, which were gradually gaining power. The star systems where prolonged fighting took place usually didn't have inhabitable planets, or they had been destroyed during the conflict. What was the value of the empty and barren regions of space? Was it the resources? Only the theory of the hypersphere, with its space-time anomalies through which spacecraft traveled through space, could provide a full answer to this question. Two space armies met in fierce battles for control of the so-called intermediate surfacing points, or, to put it simply, systems from where it was possible to jump to the central worlds. So far, neither side had managed to gain a foothold and to create a powerful barrier that would block the passage of the enemy squadrons onto a new hypersphere horizontal. This had resulted in a desperate stalemate. The military space forces of the Alliance could not strike directly at the enemy planets, and the fleet of the Free Colonies was basically trapped, for any move bypassing these systems would lead the ships into uncharted space. At a time when hypersphere navigation was in its infancy and taking its first timid steps in studying the anomalies, such movement of the troops bordered on madness. It would take years of exploring and mapping new hypersphere routes to bypass the systems where both sides had lost so many lives and so much technology. Thus, Admiral Nagumo's plan didn't promise a quick end to the war. On the contrary, exploring the periphery and organizing military bases in all the systems found in the unexplored sections of space would prolong the war indefinitely. But with a skillful approach and sufficient forces, it guaranteed the Alliance's victory in the long term. Kupanov allowed the gathered officers to absorb the idea of a new strategy, and then, deciding that enough time had been spent on understanding the spatial scheme, moved on to the specifics of the task set before the Seventh Fleet. Another two markers appeared away from the site of military action.
Gentlemen, here you can see the bases of the Free Colonies fleet. General Staff Intelligence has managed to not only find out their locations, but also determine the purpose and the approximate structure of these objects. In our case, we will focus on the MR5608 star system, which contains 6 planets. The 4th planet has an oxygen-containing atmosphere and, according to our information, has a powerful network of RW bases, containing all the Alliance technology captured by the colony's fleet over the past few years. The planet is a threat not only because of its well-organized, multi-layered planetary and space defenses. Firstly, this star system is considered an important strategic node in the hypersphere network by High Command. And secondly, the RW bases are conducting intensive studies of the captured servo machines, while the testing grounds are used to perfect ways of fighting against our planetary technology and to test new weapon systems. The task set before our fleet is to make a hyperspace jump to star MR5608, break through the enemy defenses, and capture the planet. Admiral Kupanov paused, watching the reaction of the ship captains and staff officers of the fleet.
"We don't have enough forces for large-scale fighting on a planet's surface," said the chief of staff in response to the admiral's expectant look. The airborne divisions are only manned by a third.
It was a sore subject that he should not have raised and provoked some displeasure from the fleet commander. It was true that the war was devouring more and more people. The phrase, human resources, was rarely uttered aloud these days, despite many thinking it. The statistics regarding human losses grew at an alarming rate, and it was clear to many of the senior officers that a couple more years of this war and...
Command is aware of these problems. They are being resolved quite successfully. We will soon move from counting the depressing number of victims to counting losses among machines.
The Admiral stressed the last word on purpose.
The new concept of warfare involves the use of fully automated servo complexes, which will be supported by androids with technical and infantry modifications. But before the latest technology joins our troops, we must destroy the enemy's research bases. We will compensate for the lack of personnel when we storm the planet, since the RW bases hold hundreds of our pilots as prisoners, and their liberation and immediate inclusion in the fighting shall be the first mission of the landing troops. This will be carried out by a specially trained commando group. Our forces will seize one of the key sites from where the freed pilots will be taken to the servo machine hangars.
I don't understand, Admiral. Which pilots are we talking about? Why are they being kept on a planet near the RW bases?
Asked Colonel Iverzev, who oversaw all the airborne units in the fleet.
We'll talk about this in the second part of the meeting, Kupinov replied. The ground operation has been planned by the fleet joint staff. We are being sent reinforcements to carry it out. One servo battalion, fully equipped with the latest technology and pilots. Our goal is to break through the space defenses and provide our assault carriers with safe approach corridors to the planet. That is what we're all going to think about.
Unona, the Gamma Laboratory Sector. Howard Ferrenier, chief designer of the Maverick modules, was not in a great mood that day. Life, which seemed perfectly clear not so long ago, had unexpectedly cracked. He began to notice that the human staff in the bowels of the bunker were being gradually replaced by machines. The research continued at full pace, but Ferrenier, who normally wasn't demanding about his living conditions and was completely absorbed in his work, began to suffer from loneliness. He rarely left the depths of the bunker these days, but today he suddenly craved to take a breath of real morning air, think about something other than his technical tasks, to look around him and understand what was really happening to the world and how global were these creeping changes. For a manager of his rank, there were no bans or restrictions on Unona. Ascending in the express elevator from a depth of 4 kilometers, Ferrenier passed the launching pads for the Nibelungs, crossed the checkpoint, and walked leisurely towards the nearest forest. Luckily, the camouflage plantations began almost immediately beyond the landing site perimeter. He was hoping to be alone, to allow himself to become who he used to be for a little while, to remember that a clear blue sky overhead and the smell of pine still existed in real life, that it was not just an extract being pumped through the ventilation system. However, it was important to remember that every square meter on Unona was dedicated to the harsh service of war. Beneath the canopy of modified pines, which grew to a height of 10 meters in just a year, lay roads, buildings, barracks, service bays, and places for personal and technology formations on Unona. In one of these squares, Ferrenier noticed a disorganized crowd of new recruits as a familiar major stood before them, making a speech. The major was in charge of the department involved in the training center for future servo machine pilots. Strolling along the path strewn with pine needles, Howard couldn't help but listen to the words and study the faces of the boys and girls, and he gradually started feeling very uncomfortable. What was happening now, if only a few years ago the servo machine pilots were all mature men and women who had usually been in combat before and knew the true price of life and death, and most importantly, had made the conscious choice to join the servo machine troops? Why was he seeing such young faces on Unona?
They shouldn't be fighting. They're only beginning their life, falling in love, Ferrenier thought, bewildered. Perhaps there's been a mistake.
They've been called to technical service, for example. And what's Major Herpak doing there? While he was thinking this, the short briefing ended, and the disorderly crowd, barely talking to each other, began to drift towards the squat barracks, safely tucked away under the masking canopy. Unable to stand it any longer, Howard called out to the Major, although they had never been friends. On the contrary, Herpak was angry at Farinier for some reason, which, however, did not extend to insubordination and was limited to only dark looks.
John, do you have a minute?
The Major stopped and then, as he looked closer and recognized Farinier, frowned.
Yes, Colonel.
He responded stiffly and excessively formally.
Tell me.
Howard ignored his tone, and like most scientists, he paid little attention to titles, subordination and such.
Tell me, John, why did they send us such youngsters?
Herpak's face darkened further. He seemed to be having trouble holding in the rage bubbling up inside him.
It's the 15th year of war, he spoke even more stiffly. If you came up to the surface more often, you would know the true state of affairs. The draft age was dropped to 15 years, 2 years ago.
My God, Farinier exclaimed. But they're still children.
Sorry, sir. Why are you telling me this?
I don't understand. What's the matter? And anyway, Herpak, why do you quietly hate me so much?
For your invention, sir. You gave the world the Maverick system. You created the phalangers and hoplites. And it is solely your fault that the only form of entertainment left in Earth cyberspace is controlling servo machines using the direct neurosensory contact module.
The Major's eyes were suddenly very bloodshot. How many accelerated graduations had he performed over the past 2 years? 20? 30? How many of his former charges were still alive? He hated Farinier, hated the scientists, the war, even himself, for continuing to produce more and more cannon fodder.
But,
Howard was taken aback,
they're not pilots. Stop looking at me like that, Major. I'm not a child killer.
But Herpak had already crossed the line leading to madness.
You are a killer, Farinier.
He hoarsely threw the terrible accusation in the colonel's face.
And they,
he turned and pointed sharply at the departing recruits.
They are already pilots, thanks to the efforts of the many virtual arenas.
I didn't create them,
Howard said defensively, stepping back a step.
I would never wish death upon.
Shut up.
Herpak exhaled violently, forgetting about the chain of command and finally losing control over his emotions.
Remember the Alone module, or the first version of the Climen system? How many children on different planets were murdered by servo machines guided by these stupid mavericks, who are capable of only death and destruction, while you were down there in your bunker, inventing anything other than something that could distinguish a child from an armed enemy?
Crimson spots appeared on Howard's pale cheeks. He had nothing to say in response to the accusations coming out of the Major's mouth. It was pointless to make excuses, to say that at the time of creating the first Mavericks, he was just an ordinary employee at the secret Gamma Laboratory base. Now he had become the chief designer, and his name would be forever cursed, inseparably linked with the most disastrous war in human history, and the most destructive planetary machine that ever existed. Herpak abruptly turned around and strode off toward the barracks, while Farinier stood rooted to the spot.
I'm cursed, he thought suddenly.
Unona, the Gamma Secret Laboratory Complex. After the failed walk outdoors, Howard Farinier was in a foul mood. He had long stopped liking what the top secret research facility was doing under his leadership. But now, despite the death of John Winston Hammer, the mastermind behind the war, head of the world government and supreme commander of the Terran Alliance, the cogs in the conflict between Earth and the colonies continued spinning. Even worse, they were picking up pace, drawing more and more planets into the deadly fighting. If war had such a thing as reasonable boundaries, these had been exceeded a long time ago. Now, with his help and direct participation, The generals of the Alliance were planning to take another step towards the abyss where all of humanity would soon fall, with nobody left to differentiate between Earth and the colonies. The madness of war had infected minds and poisoned them with many years of fighting. For some, the global massacre had become their life's purpose, while others lacked the courage to stand up to the insane plans. And still others were only looking out for number one, or no longer cared, their souls and minds devoured by war.
What am I going to do?
Ferenyi wondered as he pondered the next technical task received from the fleet joint staff. It was easy to make excuses for oneself. Firstly, he had been given a clear and categorical order, disobeying which could mean death. Secondly, automated systems with elements of AI came into use a long time ago. Cyber systems were first armed at the dawn of the space age, long before the Great Exodus. There was no longer any point digging through the archives to determine which Terran government first crossed the line by basing its military policy on the principle of the end justifies the means. What use was there in searching for excuses in the history of the 21st century when he, Howard Ferenyi, had created the Maverick software package 15 years ago, with the first version being codenamed Alone? He had created the cyber monster, while the military had simply let it loose. The independent behavior software package for planetary combat technology, created as an analogy for the walking servo machines of Debog, launched his stellar career and led to the savage destruction of dozens of colonized worlds. The servo machine was an immensely complex, uniquely powerful, and flexible creation, and Howard knew better than most that the planetary servo mechanisms he had helped create were simply incomparable. Neither people nor preceding planetary technology could withstand the walking combat servo mechanism, whose design utilized the experience gained from previous technology wars. Together with locomotor systems borrowed from nature and polished to perfection by billions of years of evolution. 15 years ago, after the sudden and painful loss in the Debog system, when the idea of a fast and victorious war against the rebellious colony suddenly choked on blood, talented engineers and cyberneticists were gathered here on Unona, in the top secret research and development complex, and shown examples of the servo machines developed by the Alliance engineers. Initially, the presented design seemed unviable and too complex to Howard. The kinematics alone made his head swim. However, nobody asked their opinion regarding the test samples created by the Alliance military-industrial complex. Everyone who arrived on Gamma was divided into groups, and a specific technical problem was set before each of them. Some were instructed to write programs for hundreds of independent subsystems that allowed the high-tech mechanical offspring to move. Others had to ensure the machine remained stable under various terrain conditions, while a third group had to develop weapon control modules. Howard Ferenyi's group was given the most challenging task, to create an independent behavior software packet that could control the highly complex cyber system. Not an autopilot, but a combat software module that could assume the role of a pilot. To put it simply, they had to create an AI that could not only control the numerous subsystems, but could also make non-standard tactical decisions in the heat of battle to gain experience and then put it into practice. The deadline for the task was ridiculous, only 3 months, but Howard and his colleagues had all conceivable and inconceivable resources placed at their disposal. They were given access to numerous top-secret developments made by their predecessors, who were undoubtedly talented cyberneticists and programmers who had created various modules for the sake of realizing their intellectual potential. In that distant December of 2609, Howard had plunged deep into the technical problem. He lived on stimulants and worked 20 hours per day. The problem seemed absolutely fascinating, and he rarely thought about the practical uses of the Maverick being created. Ferenyi's group wrote the Alone module in 2.5 months. Ground testing of the first complete AI combat module went well, with minor defects being corrected on the go, and soon the first Mavericks joined the troops. Compared to the power, maneuverability, endurance, and autonomy of the servo machines, other kinds of offensive planetary technology look like fragile children's toys, but Nevertheless, the alone system received...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.